Hi friends, today we will discuss something about calcium metabolism and this lecture will focus on hypercalcemia. You can download the PDF of this lecture from the app MediLectures. Link is present in the description and you can also give a test on hypercalcemia which is purely based on Harrison. So when we talk about calcium metabolism, calcium ion plays a very critical role in normal cellular functional and signaling. Also, it regulates diverse physiological processes like neuromuscular signaling, cardiac contractility, hormone secretion, and blood coagulation. Thus, it has to be maintained in a very narrow physiological range, which is around 8.9 to 10.1 milligram per deciliter. Now, this range is mainly maintained by parathormone and active form of vitamin D, which is 125 dihydroxy vitamin D. Now, this whole is maintained by parathyroid gland, kidneys, intestine, and bones. So mainly these organs are the one which take part in calcium regulation in our body. So hypercalcemia is defined by calcium levels more than 10.5 milligram per deciliter. So let's go in detail. First we will see the etiology, what are its clinical manifestations, the diagnostic approach to hypercalcemia, and finally treatment part. Now before going to the etiology, let's see how calcium is regulated in our body. So when the calcium falls below the level of 8.9 in the physiological range, which is 8.9 to 10.1, first of all, this fall in extracellular fluid calcium level will trigger an increase in parathormone through the parathyroid gland. This occurs by the calcium sensor receptor which are present on the parathyroid cells. These have calcium sensing receptors. Now this PTH in turn results in increased tubular reabsorption of calcium by the kidney. There is increased calcium reabsorption from the kidney and there is increased calcium resorption from the bone. That is, calcium is released from the bone. Also, it stimulates formation of 125 dihydroxy vitamin D from the kidney, which also increases the intestinal calcium absorption. This active form of vitamin D acts on intestine to increase the intestinal calcium absorption. So collectively, these homeostatic mechanisms serve to restore the serum calcium levels to normal. Now, vitamin D in our body is first converted to 25 hydroxy vitamin D in the liver and finally converted to the active form, which is 125 dihydroxy vitamin D, which is converted in the kidney. Now coming on to the causes in detail, we have causes with excessive PTH production and other causes in which there will be decreased PTH. The calcium will increase due to any other cause and there will be negative feedback inhibition of PTH. So in excessive PTH production, what happens is there is PTH production which is not appropriately suppressed by increased serum calcium levels. Since we all know PTH leads to increased serum calcium, but this increased serum calcium will not be able to suppress the PTH production. So what are the causes? It can occur in primary hyperparathyroidism, which can be most commonly due to adenoma, hyperplasia, or rarely carcinoma. So in these conditions, there is increased parathyroid cell mass and impaired feedback inhibition by the calcium. There can be tertiary hyperparathyroidism, in which long-term stimulation of PTH secretion occurs in cases of renal insufficiency. Since kidneys are not able to form active form of vitamin D, so there will be stimulation of parathormone due to hypocalcemia leading to long-term increase in parathormone. Rarely there can be एक्टोपिक पीटीएच सीक्रेशन फ्रॉम अ ट्यूमर. नाउ अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कंडीशन इज फैमिलियल हाइपोकैल्स्यूरिक हाइपरकैल्सीमिया. नाउ दिस फैमिलियल हाइपोकैल्स्यूरिक हाइपरकैल्सीमिया इज अ ऑटोसोमल डोमिनेंट कंडीशन विच कैन हैव आइदर ऑफ द थ्री म्यूटेशंस. द मोस्ट कॉमन म्यूटेशन इज इनएक्टिवेटिंग म्यूटेशन इन कैल्शियम सेंसिंग रिसेप्टर CASR विच लीड्स टू FHH टाइप 1. रेयरली देयर कैन बी म्यूटेशन इन G-alpha-11 प्रोटीन विच लीड्स टू FHH टाइप 2 और वेरी रेयरली देयर कैन बी अ म्यूटेशन इन अडेप्टर रिलेटेड प्रोटीन कॉम्प्लेक्स 2 सिग्मा 2 AP2S1 विच लीड्स टू FHH टाइप 3. नाउ बीट एनी ऑफ दिस म्यूटेशन ऑल ऑफ दिस विल इम्पेयर द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर कैल्शियम सेंसिंग बाय द पैराथायरॉयड ग्लैंड्स. सो द पैराथायरॉयड ग्लैंड्स विल नॉट बी एबल टू सेंस द एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर कैल्शियम एंड विल लीड टू इनअप्रोप्रिएट पीटीएच सिक्रीशन. देयर विल बी वेरी हाई पीटीएच सिक्रीशन एंड देयर विल बी इंक्रीज रीनल ट्यूबुलर कैल्शियम रीअब्सॉर्प्शन. सो देयर विल बी इंक्रीज कैल्शियम रीअब्सॉर्प्शन एज अ रिजल्ट ऑफ इंक्रीज पीटीएच. नाउ ऑल्टरेशन इन CASR फंक्शन कैन ऑल्सो अकर ड्यू टू लिथियम थेरेपी. नाउ अदर देन दीज कॉजेस रेस्ट ऑल कॉजेज विल हैव सप्रेस्ड पीटीएच ड्यू टू हाइपर कैल्शियम. दीज इंक्लूड हाइपर कैल्शियम ऑफ मैलिग्नेंसी एक्सेसिव 125 डायहाइड्रोक्सी विटामिन डी प्रोडक्शन प्राइमरी इंक्रीज इन बोन रिजॉर्प्शन एक्सेसिव कैल्शियम इनटेक एंड सम अदर कॉजेज. सो वी विल डिस्कस देम वन बाय वन. नाउ ऑल्दो पीटीएच सिक्रीशन बाय द ट्यूमर्स इज एक्सट्रीमली रेयर एज वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस दैट एक्टोपिक पीटीएच सिक्रीशन इज वेरी रेयर इन ट्यूमर्स. मैनी सॉलिड ट्यूमर्स प्रोड्यूस पीटीएच रिलेटेड पेप्टाइड. सो दिस पीटीएच रिलेटेड पेप्टाइड इज प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय मैनी सॉलिड ट्यूमर्स एंड इट हैज होमोलॉजी विथ पीटीएच इन द फर्स्ट 13 अमीनो एसिड्स. सो इट इज सिमिलर इन फर्स्ट 13 अमीनो एसिड्स. इट मेनली बाइंड्स टू पीटीएच रिसेप्टर जस्ट लाइक द पीटीएच एंड लीड्स टू एक्शन सिमिलर टू पीटीएच. सो इन द बोन्स इट विल कॉज रिजॉर्प्शन. इट विल लीड टू रिजॉर्प्शन ऑफ बोन्स एंड इन किडनीज इट विल लीड टू इंक्रीज्ड 125 डायहाइड्रोक्सी विटामिन डी. सो एज सच वी डोंट हैव इंक्रीज्ड पीटीएच बट द सिमिलर पीटीएच रिलेटेड पेप्टाइड विल बी प्रेजेंट. When we consider the PTH levels, these will be decreased as these will be inhibited by increased serum calcium. Now the other mechanism by which tumors can lead to hypercalcemia is lytic skeletal metastasis. In this, there will be lysis of bone leading to hypercalcemia and there will be inhibition of PTH hormone. For example, in breast carcinoma and myeloma. Now, hypercalcemia associated with granulomatous diseases like sarcoidosis, tuberculosis, silicosis or tumors like lymphoma is caused due to excessive 125 dihydroxy vitamin D production. So, these diseases what these lead to is these will convert more of 25 hydroxy vitamin D to 125 dihydroxy vitamin D in the kidneys. And this will lead to increased intestinal calcium absorption, increased intestinal calcium reabsorption. And the PTH will be as a result suppressed due to hypercalcemia. Now we have certain other conditions which can lead to primary increase in bone resorption like hyperthyroidism, immobilization, and as we have discussed, lytic skeletal metastasis as in breast carcinoma, myeloma. There can be excessive calcium intake as in milk alkaline syndrome or total parenteral nutrition and some other causes, for example, endocrine disorders like adrenal insufficiency, pheochromocytoma, VIPoma. All these can lead to hypercalcemia. Important to note are medications, thiazides, vitamin A and antiestrogen. So all these causes will lead to hypercalcemia with suppressed PTH. On the other hand, when the hypercalcemia is due to increased PTH, we will have increased PTH levels as in case of primary hyperparathyroidism and some other causes like FHH. Now, after we have discussed the etiology, let's come on to the clinical manifestations. First of all, the mild hypercalcemia, which is defined by serum calcium level 11 to 11.5 milligram per deciliter, is usually asymptomatic and it is recognized on routine calcium measurements. On the other hand, some patients can present with vague neuropsychiatric symptoms like trouble in concentrating, ability, personality changes, and some can even complain of depression. Some other presenting symptoms can be peptic ulcer disease, nephrolithiasis, and there is increased fracture risk in patients even with mild hypercalcemia since it is leading to bone resorption. When the hypercalcemia becomes severe, that is more than 12 to 13 milligram per deciliter, patients usually complain of lethargy, stupor, and finally coma. There can also be gastrointestinal symptoms ranging from nausea, anorexia, constipation, and even pancreatitis. Now, a very important point is that hypercalcemia leads to decreased renal concentrating ability. So, the patients can present with polyuria and polydipsia, and many patients are dehydrated. Now, long-standing hyperparathyroidism leading to hypercalcemia can present with bone pain as well as pathological fractures. Now, when we consider the ECG changes, hypercalcemia can lead to bradycardia, atrioventricular block, and short QT interval. On the other hand, hypocalcemia leads to prolonged QT interval. Now, coming on to the diagnostic approach, the first step in the diagnostic evaluation of hypercalcemia or hypocalcemia is to ensure that alteration in serum calcium is not due to serum albumin. So, we have to correct according to the serum albumin. Now, each 1 gram per deciliter decrease in serum albumin will lead to decrease in total calcium by 0.8 milligram per deciliter without affecting the ionized calcium concentration. So, we have the corrected calcium levels as measured total calcium plus 0.8 into 4.1 subtracted by serum albumin. Now, this 4.1 represents average albumin levels. Now, after we have checked that serum albumin correction is done, detailed history is taken from the patient since it may provide important clues regarding the etiology of hypercalcemia. So, what has to be included in our history? It should include history regarding medication use, since we know thiazides, vitamin A, and anti-estrogens can lead to hypercalcemia. It should also include any previous history of neck surgery or any history of systemic symptoms which can be suggestive of sarcoidosis or lymphoma. Now, when we talk about the parathyroid hormone levels, it is the second most important lab test and it will determine whether it is due to increased PTH secretion or hypercalcemia is leading to suppression of PTH. Now, one important function of PTH is to decrease the phosphate level. So, increased PTH is always associated with hypophosphatemia, and when we get the triad of increased PTH with increased calcium and decreased phosphate, it is always a case of primary hyperparathyroidism. Now, serum creatinine should be measured to assess the renal function. As we know, hypercalcemia leads to polyuria and polydipsia, also affects the renal function, and impaired renal function can affect the clearance of parathormone, in turn leading to increased PTH levels. Now, calcium clearance upon creatinine clearance ratio is very important in diagnosing cases of हाइपोकैल्शियुरिक हाइपरकैल्शीमिया। सो व्हेन वी टेक द रेशियो ऑफ कैल्शियम क्लियरेंस दैट इज यूरिन कैल्शियम अपॉन सीरम कैल्शियम टू दैट ऑफ क्रिएटिन क्लियरेंस दैट इज यूरिन क्रिएटिन अपॉन सीरम क्रिएटिन, इफ दिस रेशियो इज कमिंग लेस देन 0.01 इट इज सजेस्टिव ऑफ एफ एच एच। नाउ इन द पेशेंट्स हु हैज फैमिली हिस्ट्री ऑफ माइल्ड एसिम्टोमेटिक हाइपर कैल्शीमिया वी शुड ऑलवेज सस्पेक्ट द केस एज एफ एच एच एंड डू द कैल्शियम क्लियरेंस अपॉन क्रिएटिन क्लियरेंस रेशियो। नाउ फॉर डेफिनेटिव डायग्नोसिस वी हैव टू डू द एनालिसिस ऑफ सी एस आर जीन, कैल्शियम सेंसिंग रिसेप्टर जीन, एंड एज वी ऑल नो दैट एफ एच एच कैन ऑल्सो बी ड्यू टू जी एन ए 11 जीन और ए पी टू एस 1 जीन, सो वी ऑल्सो नीड द एनालिसिस ऑफ दीज जीन्स। नाउ डायग्नोसिस ऑफ एफ एच एच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज इट कैन प्रेजेंट विद increased PTH along with increased calcium as with other primary hyperparathyroidism cases, but it should be excluded because parathyroid surgery is ineffective in FHH. Parathyroid surgery is ineffective. So this FHH needs to be excluded in every case of hyperparathyroidism leading to hypercalcemia. Now, when in investigations we get low parathormone level due to hypercalcemia due to negative feedback, these are usually due to non-parathyroid mediated hypercalcemia, which can be malignancy associated most commonly. And this malignancy can lead to lytic type of hypercalcemia or PTH related peptide leading to hypercalcemia, or it can also be due to granulomatous diseases, which leads to increased formation of active form of vitamin D leading to hypercalcemia, which in turn suppresses PTH. Now coming on to the final part, that is treatment. So it is important to note that mild asymptomatic hypercalcemia do not require immediate treatment and management should be directed by underlying diagnosis. So according to etiology, we have to direct our management. On the other hand, when we have a patient with significant and symptomatic hypercalcemia, he or she will require therapy independent of the etiology of hypercalcemia. So in this significant hypercalcemia, the initial therapy begins with first volume expansion, because hypercalcemia invariably leads to dehydration. So we have to replace the volume. 4 to 6 liters of normal saline, 4 to 6 liters of normal saline may be required in the first 24 hours. So we have to replace the volume. Now while replacing the volume, we have to keep in mind the underlying comorbidities like CHF. So in these patients, volume replacement should be done cautiously. So we can also use loop diuretics, for example, in patients with CHF to enhance sodium and calcium excretion. Loop diuretics will be helpful for calcium excretion and will also be helpful in patients with CHF to reduce the volume overload. However, it should not be used until the volume status had been restored to normal. Now, the third category of drugs which can be given is bisphosphonates. So these bisphosphonates should be used if there is increased calcium mobilization from the bone, which can be due to malignancy or severe hyperparathyroidism. So what drugs can be given? We can use zoledronate, which is given IV 4 mg over 30 minutes. We can use pamidronate, which is given IV 60 to 90 mg over 2 to 4 hours. We can also use ibandronate IV 2 mg over 2 hours. So the onset of all these drugs is 1 to 3 days. The onset of action takes 1 to 3 days. And normalization of calcium takes place in 60 to 90% patient. So 60 to 90% will have normal calcium after treating with these drugs. Now, an alternative to bisphosphonates is gallium nitrate. It is given in a dose of आईवी 200 मिलीग्राम पर मीटर स्क्वायर ऑफ बॉडी सरफेस एरिया, इट इज गिवन डेली डेली फॉर 5 डेज, डेली फॉर 5 डेज, बट इम्पॉर्टेंट कंसिडरेशन इज द गैलियम नाइट्रेट इज हैविंग नेफ्रोटॉक्सिक इफेक्ट्स, नेफ्रोटॉक्सिक इफेक्ट्स. नाउ वी हैव अ ड्रग नोन एज डिनोसुमाब, इट इज अ मोनोक्लोनल एंटीबॉडी अगेंस्ट रैंक लिगेंड एंड इट इज यूज इन हाइपरकैल्सीमिया विच इज रिफ्रैक्टरी टू बिसफॉस्फोनेट्स. नाउ इट इज गिवन इन अ डोज ऑफ सबक्यूटेनियस 120 मिलीग्राम ऑन डे 1, डे 8, डे 15, डे 29 एंड देन एवरी 4 वीक्स. Now this dosing is very important to remember in case of denosumab. Now dialysis is rarely needed in some instances. Glucocorticoids can be used when the hypercalcemia is 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D mediated, as glucocorticoids reduce the conversion of 25-hydroxyvitamin D to the active form, that is 1,25-dihydroxyvitamin D. So we can use drugs like IV hydrocortisone, IV hydrocort 100 to 300 milligram daily, or we can also give oral prednisolone around 40 to 60 milligram daily. So this has to be given for 3 to 7 days. Now other drugs which can inhibit the conversion of active form of vitamin D is ketoconazole, chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine. So that's all for the hypercalcemia. I hope you liked the lecture. Please hit the like button.